And the secret is that when people ask me, they're like, hey, so I like to back your Kickstarters. Who do you think, you know, who should I get a signed copy of? I'm always like, get Gemma's signed copy. She's the coolest. Oh, she's not the coolest is the wrong word. It's just, that's what I would do if I was doing it.
My parents are actors, both of them. Oh. And so I grew up hearing a lot of dialogue, hearing a lot of monologues, theater, film, TV. And I was always fascinated, radio. And I was always fascinated by the way that you can bring character across very quickly in terms of the way that somebody speaks. And the other thing is that voice is so essential to me that if I don't, you know, it's like 9 times out of 10, I'm writing things in first person. And if I don't get the person's voice right, then I can't write the story. So
yeah.
Yeah, definitely. First person always lends itself better to that. I think sometimes you have to fight for that for that first person to not be you. Because it was there was a display in the Royal Ontario Museum of ichthyosauri or ichthyosauruses or whatever. They were fully assembled. At least two of them fully assembled and hanging from the ceiling. And it was back then that was the end of the dinosaur exhibit. And now it's the middle of the dinosaur exhibit. It sort of goes around in a curve. Mm-hmm. But back then it was like you get to the back and there was this cave and you walked into the cave and you were stuck in there because there was it was like you had to turn around and get out the same way you got in. And the walls were all covered in embossed sort of fossils. Mm-hmm. And everything was painted black or gray. The inside of the and it was there was sort of a cave inside the cave that was the display.
Mm-hmm.
And the bottom of that display was covered in sand, gray sand. There was watery light coming down. There was this sound like sloshing, like the inside of a shell or the inside, you know, the blood inside your ear as you stick a shell on it. And there was this real feeling that if you climbed over the barrier, which you would always have like an urge to do as a child, you would just end up at the bottom of a sea of dust, grinning skeleton fish. kind of swimming around.
That is weird.
Oh yeah. And I wrote a poem about that once. And I did have dreams about being stuck in the cave at the end of the dinosaur exhibit.
Wow, that
I plunged into that pretty early. You know, the thing that fascinates you and horrifies you, and it kind of horrifies you because it fascinates you, and it fascinates you because it horrifies you.
Yeah, exactly. It's so much. There's so, we have so much weird brain damage as horror people, right? Like because we truly do love the terror part of it, but we're also terrified of it. It is like watching a car crash. That's the thing, right? Like we know it's horrible. We know we should look away. We can't because it's so compelling. It's just awful.
It's the stuff that everybody does want to look away from. And you know, I realize that my impulse is to laugh. I'm not laughing at the idea of death,
right?
But I'm laughing at the fact that that it is everywhere.
Yeah,
death is everywhere.
It's true. And I think that maybe that's what we are trying to do, is maybe coming to some kind of like control or grips with the fact that we can't control death. Yes. We can't control the existential threat. It is
and
there.
In fact, we
that's
can't control anything.
Yeah,
we so have no control over. So coming to grips with your lack of control, which is hard. So I spent a long time thinking that there was something irretrievably wrong with me. I genuinely believe that had there been people looking to give a diagnosis of Asperger's to me when I was in the worst part of my life, which was probably like when I was around 8, 9, 10, 11,
mm-hmm.
That potentially I would have gotten that diagnosis. But of course, they weren't looking for it in girls, and they weren't looking for it at all.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
There was no distinction. You know, there was no understanding that the spectrum went that far in either direction. And the idea of monstrosity became fascinating to me,
mm-hmm.
I think, for that reason. But when you're talking about human monsters, why do people do the things they do? And 9 times out of 10, it's out of fear. You know, and I think fear is something that everyone can understand if
yeah.
they allow themselves to understand it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that fear is something, you know, fear and the wish for power when you feel yourself powerless.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, listen, that shit gets twisted. You eventually become a human corkscrew and you are kind of broken and there is nothing to be done about it, depending on how far you go in that direction. But I think because of that, that urge to unpack the similarities between yourself, the quote-unquote normal person, and a person who does horrifyingly abnormal things,
mm-hmm.
is one of the reasons that we tend to almost blunder into a place of extreme empathy.
Mm-hmm.
And the empathy is not forgiveness. The empathy
yeah.
is not, oh, well, that's okay. You know, the
right.
empathy is more, oh, okay. All right. Well, I get, okay. That's really terrible. Yeah. I always think of that line from Manhunter and Red Dragon, where Will Graham says, I feel awful for the child that the Red Dragon was.
Yes.
But the adult, he needs to die.
Exactly.
Yeah. And both of those things can be true. The second thing is that, like I said, I've spent a lot of time thinking of myself as a monster. But the fact is that I am not a monster.
You are not. You are wonderful.
But I spent a lot of time thinking of myself as being like too much,
mm-hmm.
too much
yep.
for everything, too much mm-hmm. for other people, too much for myself, too much for my life. The process of having a child has really helped me in that regard. Finally, I think it's gotten me to a place where as an older person, I'm going to be 55 this year, where I feel like, you know, anger really is an energy, and I don't have the spoons for that anymore. I don't have the spoons to be unkind anymore, mm-hmm. to be like, to put myself out to be unkind to people. I want to be kind, and I work at it.
That's awesome.
And I think essentially it helps me. It's like some kind of self-help thing to mm-hmm. just go, okay, I understand why you're doing that, and I'm not going to say anything about it. Or if I do say something about it, I'm just going to point out that thing that you're doing.
Yeah. And that is such a...
Because maybe you don't know where that is coming from.
Right.
I usually go for the Rapture, which was written and directed by Michael Tolkien. Mm-hmm. And I believe it came out in 1990.
Mm-hmm.
Might have been a little before that. It was actually one of the first things that I reviewed, although I was, you know, not a real reviewer back then. I was reviewing for copies. Okay, so essentially he takes the idea of the Rapture and he plays it out without any kind of satire, without any kind of outside application. It's just like, here's this woman. When we meet her, she's an atheist, and she's living a kind of decadent lifestyle that is not, in fact, satisfying to her. She has a moment, a numinous moment, a vision. Because of this vision, she converts to Christianity and finds in that faith something which is very satisfying for her. She marries, she has a child. A series of new visions tell her that the world is going to end. And she and her child, her husband has died, go out into the desert, and they wait for God to return to Earth. And when I got to that point, I was just like, this is brilliant. And I eventually bought it on DVD because somebody needed to own it. I'm not even religious, and it terrifies me. Right now I'm working on a sword and sorcery story for a new sword and sorcery sort of weird tales type magazine. It's, you know, really the first of those that I've done in a very long time. I started out being more interested in fantasy, mm-hmm. and sword and sorcery was certainly part of that. Uh-huh. So it's fun. It's kind of like running your own D&D campaign inside your brain. But because it's me, there's a lot of weirdness.
I love it.
Weirdness and darkness.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and other than that, still working on those two novels, and I've actually set a deadline for three chapters and an outline for both of them.
Great,
and we'll see.
Oh my gosh! All right, well we're rooting for you, and then you're gonna be writing with us for our anthology, yes. Playlist of the Damned, which is gonna be kind of awesome.
Playlist of the Damned.
I love music so much. So yeah. I just think it's gonna be super fun. So yeah. All right, thanks, Gemma. You're the best. I absolutely adore you, and I think you're so talented. And thank you so much for letting me have a little bit of your time.
Thank you very much for asking me.